And Edberg found the joy of U.S. Open victory. In golf, Meg Mallon won her first U.S. Open. And Payne Stewart captured his with this playoff putt. Pete Weber pulled his way from the fifth position to the U.S. Open crown. And Anne-Marie Duggan joined the U.S. Open elite field last year with her first major championship. Now the first U.S. Open title of 1992 is on the line, and another challenger can emerge a champion. ESPN presents the championship round finals of the BPAA United States Open, live from Fountain Valley Bowl, located in Fountain Valley, California. Starting from the number five position, Anne-Marie Duggan will try to become the first repeat champion in the history of the U.S. Open. Tonight's number four seed, Carol Gianotti of Perth, Australia, will shoot to become only the second foreigner to capture an Open title. Meanwhile, last year's top seed, Leanne Barrette, has her heart set on her very first major championship. Red-hot Tish Johnson has also set her sights on becoming the 1992 United States Open titleist. While 17 Pro Tour victories later, tonight's leading qualifier, Aleta Sill, will need to win just one game to clinch her first U.S. Open championship and $18,000. Welcome to Fountain Valley Bowl, located in Fountain Valley, California, the site for the second consecutive year of the Women's BPAA U.S. Open. Hi, everybody. I'm Denny Schreiner, along with Jan Schmidt, and welcome to the finals of the most prestigious event in women's professional bowling, the United States Open. And, Jan, what would it mean to any of our top five finalists tonight to become this year's Open champion?
Oh, Denny, to win a U.S. Open is so very special. The player that wins tonight will forever be remembered as a U.S. Open champion. And the respect and recognition she's going to gain from her peers and the rest of the bowling world is unmatched in any other event.
Always intense pressure when you're trying to win in the championship round, but tonight the Open is on the line, so is there even more pressure yet added?
Oh, there's much added pressure tonight, and the player that handles it tonight will be the one that wins.
And the lady who handled it best a year ago in the United States Open Championship was Anne-Marie Duggan, and she looked back a year at her first Open title.
Winning the U.S. Open was the most memorable moment in my bowling career. Last night, we attended a dinner in honor of Marion Ladwig and the past U.S. Open champions. She won the event four times in a row when it was a BPA All-Star. I would love to become the first person to repeat the BPA U.S. Open.
And the opening match features our defending champion, Anne-Marie Duggan, and Carol Gianotti. So, for Anne-Marie, a long, hard road, but she did it a year ago. Will she do it again tonight?
I make no predictions yet.
Wait and see what happens the first game, right? Lanes have not been touched since the players finished the third round of match play here about 1:15 this afternoon, and Anne-Marie opens strong with a strike.
And the players liked this pair of lanes this morning. They all bowled very well here.
Top five finalists averaged just a little better than 222 on this championship round pair. The entire field averaged about 197. So those who made the match play portion obviously figured out the lanes, and Carol Gianotti opens with a strike as well. Two players are very good friends, and of course Carol wants to say hello to everybody in Morley, Perth, Australia. Morley is a suburb of Perth. Very small area, but nonetheless, I'm sure that they're all cheering at this point in time, hoping for a double, and the four falls, but the nine doesn't.
That was a real good shot by Carol, ball finishing a little hard, nine pin not kicked out. She's happy, though, that the four did go.
So we're looking down at the fingers, 56 games this week, and I think all the ladies right now are showing a little wear and tear.
They are. It's the fifth week of the season, and we're all starting to feel it.
Especially for a player like Anne-Marie, because she's made five consecutive finals, four championship round appearances. That's a lot of bowling in 5 weeks' time.
She seems to be handling it about the best of all of them. Her hand's in pretty good condition.
She's been working very hard on her physical and mental games, and she's been working out as well, so she's in excellent shape. And a double for the defending champ.
And Marie starts with, there you see, with her knees bent, five-step approach, pushes the ball on her second step, gets very low to the line, a very powerful release, a lot of rotations.
Just bowled absolutely beautifully in the final round of match play when she moved from seventh place to fifth and had to defeat a good friend of hers, Wendy McPherson, in the position round game to nail down the number five position. Anne-Marie with a pocket hit and leaves the soft 10 pin.
And Anne-Marie took an interesting approach to that position round game. She knew that that pair had been not too great for her, so she looked at it by just shooting spares. There's that last shot she just threw for a soft 10 pin. The 6 pin just did not kick back.
8 pin was there for just a moment. That's what Anne-Marie was shrugging about on the way back to the ball return. Cross lane at the 10. Cross lane spares did not appear to be much of a problem this week, Jan. Of course, the oil pattern was a little bit longer here for the U.S. Open.
It was, and it made spare shooting easier. You're able to go pretty direct at those spares.
9 pin lead for Anne-Marie Duggan. Carol Gianotti with another solid strike on lane 54.
Carol Gianotti standing very straight. Five-step approach actually pushes the ball away on her first step. Very unusual. This is because her foot speed is very quick. She needs to push the ball in order to get it in there in time with her feet. Rolls the ball very early.
Strike here, and she leads by one. Opening game of the 1992 BPAA United States Open. Nice flush hit, but this time the four pin stands. It's been a very solid season for Carol thus far. She's third in average and also third in match play record.
And that's something she had been working on. She told us last week she was not winning enough matches. She said she came out this week and was much more aggressive and won 15 matches.
Well, I think in the first 2 weeks of the tour, she actually knocked down more pins than the fourth and fifth qualifiers for the championship round, but she didn't win enough matches.
That's right. 30 pins a game over 24 games adds up to a lot of pins.
Anne-Marie with a strong contingent of family and friends cheering her on this week. She's from nearby La Habra, California.
She is, and she wanted to say hi to Pat's mom, Mary, and Don, and Aunt Jan, who is Aunt Joan, excuse me. Pat's family.
Solid 9 pin. Bad break there for Anne-Marie Duggan. It's interesting because when you had a chance to talk with her earlier today, she said that basically this week all she was looking for was a good showing, really wasn't thinking about making it to the championship round.
That's what she told me. She said that she just wanted to bowl well and she would be happy. Now she's probably thinking about it a little bit, trying to win back-to-back titles, but...
Saves the wood on the 9-pin spare. Well, no player has ever won back-to-back in the United States Open. Of course, when this tournament was the old BPAA All-Star, Marian Ladewig won 4 consecutive All-Stars and 8 overall.
Anne-Marie making sure she gets that ball to the right so it didn't hook away and barely getting back to touch that 9-pin.
A little more direct. Wall shot works almost as 7-pin remains. Leanne Barrette is qualified number 3, Tish Johnson number 2, and Aleta Sill, who almost didn't even bowl this event, is our top seed.
Ball hitting very light, head pin coming off the wall, but not kicking out the 7.
Took out the 4 and the 5, but kind of quit working at that point in time, and now it's a 7-pin match. The opening game of this year's United States Open. Second consecutive year. It's been held here at Fountain Valley Bowl in Fountain Valley, California. Wonderful, beautiful facility, and the staff really did a marvelous job at executing the tournament this year.
They were very well prepared, treated us just wonderfully this week.
Another high hit for Gianotti, a strike on 54, and if she could stand on 54 all day long, she might really be some trouble. Told me, and of course you as well, that she's absolutely flabbergasted to be bowling in the championship round of the United States Open.
And Carol has never even cashed in the U.S. Open event, and she was just thrilled this afternoon.
Not thrilled about that as the A-10 pops up with the longer oil pattern. If you don't throw a good shot, Jan, there's a possibility of that A-10.
Because the ball deflects and does not take out the 8 pin, and the 6 pin wraps around the 10. Now you can see the ball not driving quite hard enough, being about halfway into the pocket.
It's almost like a throwback to the old style condition. In talking to Aleta Sill, you know, earlier today she left the sour apple, the 5-7-10. So gives you some idea of what kind of condition they're up against. Gianotti down by 19 in game number one of the U.S. Open.
I have had the pleasure of winning the U.S. Open twice and making the finals here this year. I have a chance at winning it three times, and I feel very blessed to have won it twice, and it would be an absolute godsend to win it three.
The BPAA U.S. Open are being brought to you by Bud Light. Everything else is just a light. By Midas for mufflers, brakes, and shocks. Nobody beats Midas. Nobody. And by Scope. The best thing, first thing in the morning. All right, midway through match number one of the United States Open. Our defending champion, Anne Marie Duggan, leads by 19. She opened the match with a double and hasn't thrown a strike since.
They've been close, though.
Up the track. Nice shot there. Solid four pin again.
And that's where both of these players were playing the entire week, in between the second and third arrows, the track area of the lane. They said that they found it, a few players did move out earlier in the week, and they found that to be too inconsistent.
High game for Anne Marie this week, 268. The low game, 154. Just goes to show you that the pros do shoot some low games, but you have to forget about those and move on to the next game or the next match.
And that's tough when you're trying to defend a U.S. Open title. But Anne Marie did say that the family support she had here really helped release the pressure.
It was a year ago that she started in this number five position, won four consecutive matches, including the title game over Leanne Barrette, to capture her first major championship. Got a handful on that shot, and there you see the six kicking out the ten.
Barely tapping that ten pin out. She's been making good shots, just hasn't been carrying. That was a good break. Carol averaged 218 on this pair.
Four consecutive strikes, but a little different version, this time on lane 54.
Set that ball very early. It hooked immediately. Onto the Brooklyn side, but she'll take it.
Really a free spirit, fun lady to be around, not only when she's bowling, but off the lanes as well.
She is. Nothing bothers Carol.
No.
Let's have a good time.
Great attitude. Has a lot of fun. Needs this one to hook or some other kind of break, and neither happens. And so instead of taking advantage of the big break on the Brooklyn, she's not able to double up.
And that was probably a result of throwing that Brooklyn, wanting to make sure that she executed that time. Got the ball started to the right. Hit some of that conditioner out past the second arrow, and the ball never came back.
Ball never thought about coming back. Excellent spare conversion, but she finds herself trailing in the match by 18. Anne Marie's on a strike. An X here really makes life miserable for Carol Gianotti.
That'd be 28 pins with two frames to go. That's tough to make up.
No, 28.
Good shot. That's the result she was looking for. Boy, both of us watched her make some key shots this afternoon as her husband and coach Pat looks on. She made some really solid professional shots down the stretch.
She did, especially in that last match on a pair that was difficult for her. Wendy had one bad shot, left a split. Anne-Marie came back and threw two quality shots to double, take over the lead.
And then she needed just a mark in the 10th frame to surpass Wendy McPherson-Papanos. One more, yes, there it is. Playing right now like the defending champion, and she looks as if she's going to advance past Carol Gianotti here in game number one. Carol is down by 38. The best that she could shoot would be 208. More than likely, that will not be enough to get to game number two. Back on the Brooklyn, and there you see it. It's going to be a fifth-place finish this week for Carol Gianotti.
And I think she's going to be very happy with that finish here at the U.S. Open.
You have to take it a step at a time. Really a wealth of physical talent. This lady can do a lot of different things. Really likes to play direct and throw the ball with a lot of velocity.
She does, and she, as we've said, mentioned before when she was on the show last week, that she makes those foul line adjustments. She realizes something isn't quite right at the line and makes the adjustments. She also does many other sports. She's into golf, indoor cricket, basketball, netball.
And another six pin remains. So for Carol Gianotti, a pretty good start to this one, but Anne Marie pretty much took care of business and threw every shot in the pocket. And after a double to start it and a strike in the seventh, eighth, and ninth, she has waltzed past Carol Gianotti with a victory in match number one.
And Carol will move on next week and be trying to make three consecutive television shows.
Yeah, heading over to Inca Lanes in Yuma, Arizona. Wonderfully beautiful facility there, brand new facility. And they always do an excellent job with the tournament. It's the final stop on the ladies' Western Swing Winter Tour. And we'll wrap things up in Yuma. And Marie Duggan coasting to a victory in the opening match. Still has a possible 246. Pretty big scores for the opening game.
That'll give her a lot of confidence to go on. Of course, she has the confidence. She knows she can do it.
Another strike as the six pin just slaps out the 10. And
that was Anne Marie's mother, Carol Sharp.
Always nice to have Mom on hand.
It was interesting because Carol Gianotti was the only player this week without family and friends here supporting her that made the telecast. She said it was very difficult on a long week. You need that help.
Well, there are a lot of ups and downs in a 56-game tournament, even for those who make the telecast. There was just some brilliant bowling in the last couple of games of this one today for players to put themselves into a position to make the telecast. Donna Adamek, Wendy McPherson, Dana Miller-Mackey, a two-time U.S. Open champion, came out of the blue to have an outside chance with a couple games to go. Anne Marie Duggan finishes up with a six-bagger, a game of 246 as she throws eight strikes in the opening game, and so Leanne Barrette had better get ready because the defending champion is also ready for her.
Winning the U.S. Open in 1989 was one of my most exciting experiences, and it gave me the confidence to go on and be Bowler of the Year for 19.
See over 20 conference winners crowned during ESPN Championship Week. The heroes of auto racing rev up for a new season of thrills. The stars of baseball are back. Don't miss spring training and baseball tonight. Olympic winners compete at the U.S. Alpine Championships. And come on board with ESPN for America's Cup excitement. Championship sports in March on ESPN.
Lopsided victory for Anne Marie Duggan in game number one. Carol Gianotti just could not figure out the left-hand lane, so therefore she loses the opening match, 246 to 182. And let's scan the rest of the top 24. Tremendous field this week. Former U.S. Open champ Wendy McPherson, sixth, and Dana Miller-Mackey has two U.S. Open titles. She was seventh.
And our 80s bowler of the decade, Lisa Wagner in eighth, and Don Adamek, two-time U.S. Open champion in ninth.
Michelle Mullen, who nearly won the U.S. Open a few years ago, was 10th, and the U.S. amateur champion, Julie Gardner, was 11th.
And a couple Californians from La Habra, Stacy Ryder in 12th, and in 13th, Pat Rossler from Santa Clara.
Number 14, Jennifer Kleekamp, or Kleamp. Oh, one more time. Why don't you help me with that one, Jan?
Kleekamp.
I thought I had it right the first time. And also, Lori Nichols was 15th.
And Jeannie Maiden in 16th, an eight-time pro titleist, and Cheryl Daniels finishing up in 17th.
Nikki Giannulli is number 18 this week, and Chris McCune back in the finals again in 19th.
And Patty Ann in 20th, and Renee Fleming, who shot one of the 300s this week, in 21st.
Joni McKim, and also Kim Carmen, the 91 Rookie of the Year in 23rd position.
And rounding out the top 24, first year as a professional, Shar Ford, and the alternate, Dee Dee Davidson, our 1991 Queens champion.
And it is a big field, 192 players this week. So let's look at the cashers from 26th through 60th place.
U.S. Open in 1988 was such a thrill because a lot of people have been saying that she can't win a major. And when I won the major, it was really a dream come true. And I think after struggling lately, winning the U.S. Open again would really top off my career. It would be so wonderful to win it again.
All right. Game number two here of the BPAA U.S. Open, featuring a player who last year that finished second and the year before was third, Leanne Barrette.
And she's looking for that U.S. Open title. She said one of her major goals now is to win a major, and she wants to do it tonight.
A little bit wide of the mark, leaves the 2-4-5, and that's something that we have seen throughout the past couple of days from Leanne. She has sprayed the ball considerably more than normal.
She has, and she had been working on trying to stand more upright at the line with her back. And now she said she bowled good 3 days, and now she feels like she's off a little bit. Ball coming behind her back a little more than normal, spraying it out to the right. She's working on it. We can see from behind how she brings it around behind her.
Fortunate that she did not chop the 2-4-5, but right now Leanne is struggling with her game, a testimony to how talented she really is. She can struggle and still end up third in the qualifying.
That's amazing. She did bowl great the first 3 days, but to struggle and still stay up there takes a lot of guts, a lot of hard work.
Good opening shot by Anne Marie, and she gets a break that she doesn't leave the four along with the nine. This must feel like old home week for her right now, especially winning the opening game.
Deja vu. I'm sure she's feeling like this is just like last year. Things are going to go my way. I'm going to go through the field.
Well, the only player ever to come close, really, to winning two United States Open championships was Betty Morris, who finished second in 1976 by just a couple of pins, came back the following year, and won in 77.
But actually, no player after winning has even made the telecast the following year. So Anne-Marie has done something special just in itself being on this show.
You know what else is unusual about this one tonight? If you take a look at Aleta Sill, Tish Johnson, and Leanne Barrette, all three of those players have led this championship, and none of them have won.
That is amazing.
Stood up a touch early on that shot, but got away with it as she leaves a solid four pin. So Anne Marie peppering the pocket, but the carry hasn't come forward.
Not yet, but she's in a good area of the lane. She has a little bit of room, it appears, and she can miss a little to the left or right and still get to the pocket.
And missing badly to the right as the four pin stands until the sweep takes it back out. So Anne Marie with her first bad shot of the evening. Now let's see if Leanne Barrette can take advantage of that. Little thump over the thumb hole, but the result is pretty nice. It's a strike on the right-hand lane.
And she's been working on staying behind the ball more, so apparently she is doing that, ball tracking up near the thumb hole. Bringing the ball behind her, letting it out to about the 10th board, coming in very strong. Yep, 10 board at 27 feet, starting at 12 out to 10 and back to 8, so she's getting about a 2-board arc. And
plenty of roll in the back end. Got that ball, I think, a little bit right of the target, and it hooked early and through the nose. It's been a slow start here in 92 for Leanne Barrette. Of course, what we consider slow, she says, hey, I'm coming along just fine here, but I think we anticipate that she's going to make the show or win virtually every week now.
Right, but she's happy with what she's doing. And like we said, she's working on some changes in her game that are going to make her even better. She's happy, so she's happy to make the telecast.
Tish Johnson, next in line in our top seed this week. Left-hander Aleta Sill out of Dearborn, Michigan. Plenty of experience, a wealth of talent, and many, many national titles among our top four finalists left here in the U.S. Open. They all know how to win. It's just a question of who will handle the pressure and lanes 53 and 54 here tonight.
And Anne-Marie comes back off that open with a strike. That's very important. That's very key mentally for her to come back from that.
The thing I was most impressed with today, obviously, was a lot more pressure for her to try and get to the telecast. But when she did throw a bad shot or when she did lose a match, didn't seem to bother her at all. She bounced right back, and that's really the sign of a player that's beginning to understand what it's all about on the national tour. Right back at him, a nice double for Anne-Marie.
It's a good break, kicking out the 4-7. That ball finished a little hard. Got good carry. There you can see she got out maybe to only the 12th board. Ball finishing a little harder, but kicking out the 4. Get out of there. Yeah.
Very deliberate. Way too much hook. And a 3-pin on lane 54 for Leanne Barrette.
Ball starting to hook very early, it appears. Earlier than it had been for her during the week. Leanne defeated Anne-Marie.
Yeah, you could flip that around from a year ago, though, when Anne-Marie defeated her for the U.S. Open title. One other point to be made about Leanne Barrette is the fact that she averaged 237.6 on this particular pair of lanes throughout the match play portion of this one, the highest by far of our top five finalists.
And it's a one-pin match. Leanne ahead by just one pin now.
Takes a look at the rack and opts to go ahead and shoot at it on lane 53 as we look graphically at the score of this close second match.
Leanne spent a lot of time over the break just visiting with her family. She said she really enjoyed it. Being able to spend time with them relaxed her, ready to come back out.
Light hit, and the 7-pin stands. 8-pin nearly toppled over for a moment and took it out, but not quite.
Leanne had appeared a look of confusion on her face on that shot. I think she thought she made a very good shot. Didn't finish as hard as she expected.
Really, she's now in the position that Lisa Wagner was in for a while when Lisa was virtually winning every event, but hadn't yet recorded a major championship. And sooner or later, everybody starts to point fingers at her. Yeah, I know that Leanne has 13 titles, and she's only 24, and she's been Player of the Year 2 years in a row, but she's never won one of the big championships. She really wants to do that badly.
She does, and I think more for everybody that expects her to, even than herself.
Mm-hmm. Is it 3 in a row? And Marie Duggan pushing all the right buttons here in the opening couple of games of the U.S. Open.
And Anne-Marie playing a very direct line. Anne-Marie's worked very hard at this, stretching her limits. Ball finishing perfect into the pocket, a little bit high, but she's been working real hard on trying to be able to close herself up. She likes to open up and go right, and she hasn't been able to do that much this swing, so she's worked hard to change that.
And when you're talking of closing up, you're speaking of shoulders?
Right. Squaring the shoulders to the foul line, not crossing as many boards.
Looking for 4 in a row. And she has it. So, Anne-Marie Duggan, the defending champ, has taken control here in game number 2. She leads by 20 and works on a 4-bagger here at the U.S. Open.
On the serious side, I just want to say winning the BPAA U.S. Open was probably one of the greatest experiences of my life. On the more humorous side, there's a standing joke on tour about me quitting. Every time I have a bad block or bad tournament, I say I'm going to quit. And the original time that I said it was in 1987, right before I won the U.S. Open.
Trailing by 20 could change the scenario if she'll throw a couple of strikes here. And during that commercial break, Leanne went for some tape and put it in the thumb hole.
She did. She must not have a good feel. Apparently lost the ball. That's something very important for bowlers to remember, that your hand is not always the same size, and you need to use tape to make that hole smaller or larger.
And one of the good tips for the amateur players is to always have a couple of pieces of tape available so that you don't hold up play.
Well, whatever she did, it worked because she threw a wonderful shot there, although she leaves the ringing 10-pin on lane 50, or I should say 54.
Great shot. Six-pin flew around the 10. Notice she's changing bowling balls to one that is shinier, harder surface to go longer down the lane and shoot the 10-pin so she doesn't have to play so large a hook or an arc.
No problem with the 10, but there is a problem score-wise. She's down by 21 as Dan and Mary look on, and right now they're obviously in the hot seat because Leanne is trailing in this match.
And she's so happy to have them here.
Oh, yeah. Very family-oriented individual.
She is. You know, interesting, she rooms alone on tour because she said she lives alone at home, and it's very hard for her to try and work into someone else's schedule. So she likes to do it that way.
Key shot, needs to get something started, and still nothing will fall. Back-to-back 10 pins. Meanwhile, in a trance, is Anne-Marie thinking, boy, I did it last year. If I can get by Leanne, then I got the two lefties above me. Maybe I can get by them and win two opens in a row and become the first player ever to do that on the ladies' tour.
In the back of her mind, and she's probably trying to tell herself, just worry about the next shot right now.
Yeah, let us worry about two in a row.
Right. Anne-Marie's up by 22, and a strike would put her up by 32 with three frames to go.
Shot, nice result, a five-bagger. And there is Carol Sharp, Anne-Marie's mother. If I'm not mistaken, the lady we identified the last time was Dick Steinbaugh's wife, who is president of the Southern Cal Bowling Proprietors Association. So want to give credit where credit is due. There she is right there to the right of Pat Duggan. And you see part of Dick Steinbaugh there as well, probably the better part, right? A little more loft, and a solid 10-pin. Boy, two good games in a row, though, for Anne-Marie. Doesn't look like she's feeling the pressure, and when you had an opportunity to talk to all five players at the end of the match play portion this afternoon, you said by far and away Anne-Marie was the most relaxed of the bunch.
She was, because she said, I have nothing to lose. I've already got a U.S. Open title. I can't go lower than fifth. I'm just going to go out there and make my shots.
She has executed to perfection. Only one miscue. That was a miss of the four pin in the second frame, but then she threw a five bagger after that to make amends.
She sure did. She said, I'm not going to let that affect me. I'm going to make up for it. And sometimes that's very hard to do in bowling. Never really can make up for a miss spare.
Just have to put it out of your mind and don't miss anymore. At this level, when you miss a one-pin spare, you normally pay for it in the end. Finally, a carry strike for Leanne Barrett, who continues to try and throw shots in the pocket. Leanne could still shoot 226, but that might not be enough.
Anne-Marie going at a 227 pace right now.
Just too many spares for Leanne, but really, when you look at it, that could have been a three-bagger in the sixth, the seventh, and the eighth.
Could have been two quality shots, 10 pins on both of them.
Needed the light hit and just didn't quite have the ball rolled up, and so she leaves out the washout. As you take a look at our perspective here from the broadcast facility.
And Leanne, that was, we talked about before, she's been spraying the ball right. Look how far the ball came back behind her. In order to get it around her hip, she has to send it way right.
Oh, and she gets a break, although it's too late in the match to make any difference. Now her best score would be 206, so on cruise control right now is the defending champ.
And she had a harder ball going straight at it, took the head pin straight back to the back wall, came back off onto the lane and kicked out the 10.
It happens when you least expect it and when you really least need it. 1991 U.S. Open champion, is looking like she wants to make it back-to-back victories.
She just is not missing.
And she opts for her second re-rack of game number two on lane 53.
She brought all of her concentration with her tonight. Needs nine pins to shut Leanne out.
A player that's focused, in control, has the right ball, the right surface, the right weights to match up with this pair of lanes. But next in line, Tish Johnson. And above her, Aleta Sill, two players that knocked down a whole lot of pins this week at Fountain Valley.
They sure did. They were trying to lap some of the field there towards the end today.
Just to give you some idea of what I'm speaking of, Aleta Sill knocked down more than 600 pins more than Anne Marie Duggan did through 56 games. She averaged 11 pins more per game. So a lot of excitement yet to come because we've got the two southpaws ready to load up and take a shot at the defending champion.
Anne Marie is pretty much, she has wrapped up this game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was just a formality. Strike here gives her 227 to go along with 246. There it is. So she's averaging a little better than 235 for the opening couple of games. And for Leanne Barrette, a second-place finish, a third-place finish, and now a fourth-place finish 3 years in a row in the U.S. Open. Next year, it's either going to be fifth or maybe even hopefully first.
I think she'll hope for first.
All right. We'll head to a break here. Game number two is already said and done. Anne Marie Duggan continues to march towards her second U.S. Open title.
Winning the 1986 BPAA U.S. Open was a thrill of a lifetime. I was on my vacation from high school. I was a senior in high school, and I had a week off and went to bowl in that. And if you ask me about the week, it's very hard to remember it. It was a blur, and it was just an incredible week. Next thing I know is I had won the tournament, and it was a thrill of a lifetime. And hopefully the record of being the youngest to have ever won it at the age 18 will hold on for a long
time. And the defending champion, Anne Marie Duggan, wins again, 227 to 195 over Leanne Barrette. And a number of dignitaries on hand here at Fountain Valley Bowl this evening for the United States Open. First and foremost, Bill Blue, the Chief Executive Officer of the Bowling Proprietors Association of America. And another important person standing by with our Jan Schmidt is the top seed this week, Aleta Sill.
Hi, Aleta. And normally when an athlete suffers an injury, it hinders their performance, and yet after being off for 3 weeks with an arm injury, you came back and led the U.S. Open. How can you explain that?
Well, I think due to the injury, I couldn't hit the ball as much as I did before, and the way I usually bowl, I hit up on it and I get a little bit earlier hook, and here I just wanted to kind of roll it at the head pin because they're a little bit tighter, so it worked to my advantage because I could just float it off my hand and just roll it.
Thanks, Aleta, and good luck. And that was Aleta Sill hoping to win her first U.S. Open title.
She rolled it well all week long. Let's take a look at some of the U.S. Open champions from yesteryear. Of course, it goes all the way back to 1971.
U.S. Open title, I had to defeat my close friend, Maury Nichols, who was also a very respected competitor of mine and someone who helped me out during my early years on tour. In the following years, my other two close friends and longtime roommates, Pat Mercantani and Anne-Marie Duggan, also won this victory. Being able to share this victory with my closest three friends that I've had out on tour has made this victory and the U.S. Open title even more.
Field of seniors compete in the GTE West Classic. Complete coverage starts Friday afternoon at 4 Eastern, live on ESPN.
Fans were standing in line for hours to get into this one. This evening, the championship round finals of the BPAA United States Open. Defending champion Anne Marie Duggan has two wins already this evening, so that's six consecutive wins in the championship round in the U.S. Open, and she starts with a strike. She'll need to against Tish Johnson.
She will. Tish has been bowling great. Tish has a lot of confidence. This is her fourth out of five television appearances. She just signed with Columbia this week and is using their equipment and is thrilled with it.
A little extra time for Tish Johnson, who intimated to you that this is a tournament she feels that she can win. It's a huge break to start off, and the animated one is happy with the Brooklyn strike.
She was really pumped up about winning this. She lost 2 years ago by one pin to Dana Miller-Mackey, and she said it's hers. She said she wants it very badly.
She averaged 219 on this pair of lanes and opens with a big double. Lots of jumping around, and Tish Johnson maybe just letting Anne Marie know that she's wired and has a good shot on this pair of lanes.
It looked like she was trying to send a message. And Anne-Marie defeated Tish, though, during match play this week. She's hoping that's the same outcome this week, today.
Anne-Marie right back at her, and there are only three left in this event. It'll be a battle from here on out to see who gets to meet the top seed, Aleta Sill. Say enough about the play of Anne Marie Duggan. Since winning this tournament a year ago, it's changed her career completely.
And that's what it'll do for you. Not only did it give her respect to others, I think it added self-respect. Gave her a lot more confidence.
Got a little too much of that one, and she said, well, Tish, you got away with one. I suppose I could take a Brooklyn here if you don't mind.
So even out the score here.
Six shots, six strikes here in the semifinal game.
And for those people who say that the women sometimes don't show a lot of emotion, I hope you're watching this match.
I know one thing, Chris Warren showed some emotion yesterday afternoon in winning. Boy, what a tremendous title match that was down Florida way. He and Vespi were locked into a matchup, and they both struck out. That's what you like to see. Another strike for Tish Johnson. Seven consecutive strikes. One thing we might add is that the lanes were not touched after the final round of match play this afternoon, so the players obviously had a pretty good feel for what to expect when they walked in the door here tonight.
They did, and they all really liked them earlier today, so...
Marie, the first to cave in to the U.S. Open pressure, leaves the 3-6 on lane 54.
Not quite as aggressive with that shot.
Looked to me like she pulled it a hair. She hasn't made many bad shots here in the championship round tonight.
No, it didn't look like she came through that quite as firm, quite as solidly, not quite as much speed.
Pin lead for Tish Johnson, who has the first four. The winner will collect $18,000. Second place worth $9,000 this week. Plenty of room this time. The six pin just takes care of the 10, and so it's a strike on 53.
And once again, she came right back after making a poor shot. Just let it go away and came right back. 47th career TV appearance for Tish.
Boy, in the last 3 years, she's probably had two-thirds of those. Wow, the 6 and the 8 both collapsed as her parents look on. Tish now with the first 5. Look at Mom after that last shot.
And this ball finishing quite hard, actually getting a very good break to kick out the 6 and the 8 pin.
mistake. One has to wonder if the adrenaline was just pumping perhaps a little bit too much for Tish to handle.
It could be. And Tish, very quick with her feet, very low at the line, and watch how she follows through to the left. She's actually so far behind the ball that she rotates through to the left instead of coming around the ball. It's a very good roll on the ball that way.
Can't handle the split, so an opening. Although it's a small one for Anne Marie Duggan, she's on a strike. We'll be back with more semifinal action after this.
I won the U.S. Open twice, and I think my second title was my most important title to me of all my titles, because I just had elbow surgery, and most of the writers and the bowling critics canceled me out, and I came back and I won my very first tournament out, and that was my most important title.
Strike in the sixth, and trailing now by just seven. If she strikes here, she's back in the lead.
That would by three pins, so this is a critical shot, and she has come through every time.
But this time, it doesn't quite develop as she leaves the 3-6-10. That would have been a great opportunity for her to jump on the mistake of Tish Johnson.
And again, pulling the ball inside of her target. Again, I think a little bit soft with the ball, not quite as firm as she had been.
Slides by the three pin. Deep sigh, long breath, and let's see if she can regroup after that mistake.
I just saw her say shoot.
Now trails by 19. Yeah, I tell you what, you don't get many chances to come back. That could haunt her before it's all over. Good strike on the left-hand lane. Let's see what Tish Johnson has cooking now in the seventh frame. Another shot wide of the mark and averted the bucket, but she still has some bowling left here in the seventh frame.
And they both started out making quality shots, and as the match gets near to the end, maybe just a little bit of tension there.
Just going to say, that's about exactly the opposite of what you want to leave in this position. Anything two pins or more is trouble now when you're trying to get to the championship game of the U.S. Open.
Wanting to make sure that ball gets across. She points it up on the 10th board, and it just hooks right by the 5-pin.
Tish Johnson still leads by 8, but keep in mind, Anne Marie is on a strike in the 7th. This one is seesawed back and forth. And again, I don't know if Tish Johnson all of a sudden has just gotten very quick with the feet or what, or if the lanes changed that dramatically, but the last three shots weren't even close.
I don't know. It appears that she's going a little farther out than she had been.
Left now with the washout. Going to try and head to the right side of the head pin. And she does. A perfect shot. But what's happened? The wheels are not only off, but they're rolling down the street.
And after just shooting a 3-pin on the other lane, she was hoping this one would do the same thing. Hook across. Got the head pin. On the right, shooting it across into the 7. Great conversion. Critical conversion.
Anne Marie needs a double. And she gets it. Wonderful shot by Anne Marie Duggan, positioning herself now to get to the title match.
She just put herself into the lead by 2 pins. Another strike here would put her 12 pins up.
Both players started with a flurry, and then all of a sudden, they both slammed into the wall once they got to the 6th frame. Now it's time to take a look at the crash report. Finish out the match. Stood up early on that shot and was very lucky indeed not to have company along with the 4 and the 7.
It was a big break kicking out the 10 pin. Giving her what should be an easy spare conversion.
Ball starts to feel a little heavy about this point in time.
Now she skid by this earlier on this lane. She's going to make sure she gets it up.
even match. As Tish Johnson enters the ninth frame, Tish can still shoot 234. And Marie's best would be 224. Well, she's back. 8-pin. Was a little late in leaving, but I'll have to ask her when this one's all said and done what happened in those three frames.
Okay, and she's setting that down right around the 10th board, which is where she was playing earlier. Very good shot. Her ball speed had increased a bit on the last couple of frames, possibly why the ball did not finish. Very direct, 10th board, all the way down the lane.
Well, Tish Johnson starting to run him out right into the crowd. One more strike here locks up the semifinal game. Boy, she just kind of got lost in space in the middle of that game.
Very unusual for Tish to do that.
Yeah, once she gets locked into a pair of lanes, normally she just throttles the pocket. Wide of the mark. And the 5-pin remains. So the score would be 223. And Marie Duggan, with three strikes, could shoot 224.
She's looking at the score right now. Anne Marie taking a look. See what she's going to need.
Nice comeback for Tish Johnson, who put together a double in the ninth and the tenth. She shoots 223. Now all she can do is sit back, cross the fingers and the toes, and hope that the defending champion doesn't come through in the clutch.
She's been doing it all week.
Got to start with the first one. And the bid to become the first player to win back-to-back U.S. Open titles falls a game short for Anne Marie Duggan. Tish Johnson relieved that she didn't give away the semifinal match. And so she will move on to the title game. And the defending champion, Anne Marie Duggan, with a game effort, will have to settle for third.
And she got up and made the shot that she needed to make.
A quality shot, a third-place finish for Anne Marie Duggan. And when we come back, the two lefties, Tish Johnson and Aleta Sill, bowl for the title.
Winning the U.S. Open was probably one of the biggest moments of my life. I remember that I had lost. I finished second in the U.S. Open in 1976 by just a few pins. And I remember sitting on the floor in the bowling center in a white skirt and just crying and crying for what seemed like an eternity, thinking I would never win because I finished second by just a few pins. And the very next year in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, I won. And it was incredible because I really felt like I had my chance and it didn't happen. It was never going to happen. So it was a tremendous...
For mufflers, brakes, and shocks, nobody beats Midas. Nobody.
And let's take a look. Anne Marie Duggan with a key shot in the 10th frame of match number one.
She was on three strikes. Her fourth one will close out the match against Carol Gianotti. Makes a great shot going out about the 10th board, coming in very hard, getting that love tap out of the gutter, kicking out the 10.
Ah, when a professional player sees that, you know you've got it all. Finished with six consecutive strikes after opening with a double, and the game finished 246 to 182. And then once again, Anne-Marie provided the heroics, this time in the seventh frame of match number two.
This to be her fifth strike in a row to give her a lead that Leanne would never be able to overcome. Again, looks like a replay of the last one we just saw, kicking the 10-pin out again.
That was a replay, or was that a different shot?
I'm not sure.
No, of course it was, the shot in the seventh frame. So this time it was a five-bagger in the middle of the match that made the difference, 227 to 195. Then the defending champion was trying to get to the title match. You needed a double and nine to tie and three to win, and this is what happened in the 10th.
And she had been coming high in this lane. She said, I need three strikes. I'm just going to make sure I get this ball out, and she did. Quality shot coming in, actually finishing harder than the others we just saw, and not kicking out the 10-pin.
So the bid for two in a row falls short. Anne Marie Duggan averaged 228.6 tonight. not quite enough, as Tish Johnson started with the first five and then threw a double in the ninth and the tenth to win 223-213. One thing is for sure, a left-hander will win this year's United States Open.
I was very fortunate to win the U.S. Open, my very first U.S. Open as an amateur. It was the first event that I bowled in as any type of competition. Didn't think that I was ever going to even have a chance to win, and I was very fortunate to win. It was the biggest highlight of my career. This being 20 years after I won my U.S. Open, I'm kind of looking for that this would be a real exciting one to win, seeing that I'd probably be the only one to win as an amateur and a professional.
Just two players left out of a field of 192, which consisted of 90 pros and 102 amateurs. Tish Johnson and Aleta Sill will bowl for the 92 U.S. Open.
And they were having a little fun out there at the start of the match.
They sure were. Now let's see how much fun they have now. Tish Johnson just bouncing all over the approach. I'd say she's got the enthusiasm for this match. How about you?
She does, but this time she's going to sit down and say, control that adrenaline.
Two completely different types of players. Aleta Sill, a real practitioner, a technician, somebody that just finds a mark and does nothing but walk up and hit it shot after shot after shot, and she leaves a 10-pin on the opening offering. And you will not see much emotion from Aleta Sill.
No, at the opposite end of the spectrum. But I think we will if she wins tonight.
Player that's had all sorts of physical problems with tendons in her wrist. Took 3 weeks off. Wasn't even sure she was going to get a chance to bowl. As you see, a beautiful trophy there that will be awarded just a few minutes from now, along with a wonderful jacket and a check for $18,000.
Aleta had some strained tendons in her arm and has been getting electronic stimulation and ultrasound, taking a lot of Motrin, just trying to be able to bowl. This is only her second event of the year. And she has 9 titles from that top seed position, but the last one back in 1989.
A terrific front runner. Came out this morning with a 150-pin lead and just kept on shooting those 220s and ended up extending the lead over Tish Johnson as she strikes in the second frame.
That's right, never gave anything away.
You know, players out here could take a lesson from Aleta in terms of once you get ahead, how you stay ahead. Inside her mark, and trouble for Tish Johnson on the right-hand lane.
And she had been sending it wide. Just going to make sure she doesn't do it on this shot. Actually sending it a little earlier than she had been, pulling it inside her target. Coming up high, and this is a difficult spare. She needs to try and take out the 2-pin and the 8-pin with the ball.
Yes, ask and ye shall receive.
And that was the first ball that went high. She had been playing around the 10th board, set that one down 12 to 11, so she did pull it 2 boards inside of her target. And she picked up that spare, not exactly the textbook way.
That was the street version. More direct, gets the hammer out on lane 53. Now let's see if the top seed can come through with a strike here and take the lead in this match. Ranked in the top 5 in career earnings. And all of a sudden, Aleta Sill looks back and says, I'm not too happy about the rack on 54. I think I'll try another.
She wants to make sure she carries this shot. It'll be a double to give her the lead.
That looks like the pocket's a little bit closed there, didn't it?
A little bit.
Good pocket for a right-hander, but not good for a left-hander.
Exactly right.
For the double and the lead. That was a very nice shot.
And we saw some reaction out of her there. Playing also around the 10th board, hitting very hard, all pins straight back. She said carry. Yes,
She's giving some back there.
Yeah, a little bit, huh? She usually saves that for the 9th and the 10th. But after all, this is the U.S. Open. More loft on this shot. And a little slap of the hands as well. So Aleta Sill has gotten Tish Johnson's attention here early on in the title match.
There we saw Aleta was also playing about the same area as Tish, but going out one board, 10 to 9 and back. A little bit more arc.
Back at you. Oh, on the other side. Second, Brooklyn, and a pat on the back, although she's patting her own back.
Mm-hmm.
Ah, there's Debbie Takahara, who is the 1991 Miss Fountain Valley, and her reign, I think, is up shortly sometime in May, but celebrities and the stars out for this one tonight at the U.S. Open. Oh, no, 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 no. Not the solid nine pin in the U.S. Open.
And she says payback. She said, it gave me that Brooklyn, but I've just been paid back.
Yep.
And this, one of the best shots a left-hander can make. Pretty much straight up 10. Solid into the pocket. Ball driving too hard, leaving the nine pin.
Playful animation from 15-time winner, Tish Johnson, who really threw a great shot there.
And Aleta, first time we're seeing her this year, went home, spent some time with her grandparents, Adeline and Steve, over the holidays. Wanted to say hello to them.
And I'm sure they're glued to the set right now, trying to cheer this shot on. Six pin stands on the right-hand lane. Both of these players have led this tournament. Both of these players have lost from the top seed position. That is not a good feeling.
That's right. And as a matter of fact, they both lost to Dana Miller-Mackey.
Mm-hmm. Bumped them both off, didn't she?
Aleta lost in 1983.
And Tish in 1990. Spare up for Aleta Sill in the fifth, and she leads by 10 as we're at the halfway point.
Interesting, Aleta only used two balls the entire week versus Tish, who used eight. So
yeah, but when you're leading and you're averaging 222, why would you go into the paddock for anything else?
She obviously had no trouble with what she had. She's using Ebonite equipment. She's an Ebonite staff member, as were all the women, variety of company staff members tonight.
Beat were a little quick, but she made the adjustment at the line. There you see Aleta turn around to, well, I had to make the adjustment on the fly that time, but it worked out very nicely. And Tish kind of looks back with a smirk and says, yeah, right, you had a strike all the way.
Tish having two titles from number two seed.
Trying to get back on track, another Brooklyn. Tish kind of ambling around, scratching her head, and it's been an unusual type of a performance for her this evening. She's been all over the road.
She's been real hot and cold, throwing great shots over and over, and then all of a sudden they're gone. There you can see inside of the 10th board, inside of her target, going left.
Well, at least her carry's good on that side. This one's inside the target as well, but it holds pocket, so Tish Johnson fighting back with a double of her own, and this match is even again.
And she's probably saying, I don't know, maybe the Brooklyns are going to carry better. I mean, great shot left that nine pin, so. And Aleta's been working on she said sometimes she moves the ball too early. Ball gets there early, and then she hits up too hard on it. Working on trying not to move the ball.
Good roll on that shot. Five pin danced around. Fans appreciative of the effort, so she comes back with a double and now takes the lead by 10. Had a feeling this one would be a high-scoring affair. These two ladies averaged about 10 pins more per game than any of the other 190 participants this week.
And they were up there the entire week, bowled well from the very beginning.
That was the old 1-2 combination once the dust settled here. Uh-oh. That shot was left, and she is left with a washout variety.
Looked like she lost that ball. I don't think she had a real good... It fell off her hand, coming up very light, not even touching the head pin. Needs to get to the right of the head pin, just as Tish did earlier, and slide it over to the 7 pin.
Missed by a whisker. Excellent shot by Aleta Sill, but she has really given an opportunity to Tish Johnson.
This was a great attempt at a spare conversion. It appeared that the head pin would get over to the 7, but not quite enough angle went behind it.
Last couple of shots have been errant on lane 54. And Tish is saying, what do you mean? I can't carry another Brooklyn? Boy, she is confused on lane 54.
She is now. The conditioner may be starting to dry up under the lights.
Tish Johnson trying to become the first multiple winner here in 1992. She won the opening event, the Las Vegas Western Open, 4 weeks ago.
That's right, and had made two other telecasts since then, attempting to win. She was saving it all for this week.
If both players strike out in the 10th, two games in the 230s.
One ball! Yeah.
Six pin falls down, so Tish Johnson has her foundation frame strike of the night.
It's a critical frame. She got that ball outside of the second arrow that time, still finishing hard, so it appears that they are drying out. Get down, man. You know it. It's mine. I'm going for it. She's pumped.
Back to the top seed. Cool, calm, and a strike for Aleta Sill, who seems to be enjoying herself right now, although she did leave a washout the last time on 53. 18,000 to the winner, that beautiful trophy. Second place worth $9,000. But as Jan put it in the open, not only your peers, but all the people in the industry remembered forever if you win a United States Open Championship.
And Aleta cannot shut Tish out here. Tish is going to have an opportunity no matter. If Aleta strikes out, Tish will have to get a double.
Worst break of the week. Excellent shot. 5-pin danced around, but the 10-pin moved a half an inch and wouldn't fall. And now the momentum swings back to Tish Johnson.
You can see the ball finishing a little late. Headpin came off the wall. Actually, 4 pins over there at the 10-pin, and none of them knocked it down.
So a tough break for the top seed, Aleta Sill, who, if she strikes here, will shoot 213. That will make Tish Johnson's job a little easier in the 10th frame.
She would only need a mark and 6 pins.
But it'll have to come on the right-hand lane, a lane, Jan, that she's struggled with the last 4 shots.
And will she consider just going Brooklyn again?
Oh, boy, I don't know. That's a good question. I don't know. We'll have to wait and find out. Up quickly. A mark and 6 to win the Open.
She's going to go for the pocket.
Oh, you have to wonder how much fate has played a part in this one. Tish Johnson had a number of breaks, and that was a huge one there. That ball could have split very easily.
She did try to get it to the pocket. She let that ball out a little further, but wound up on the nose. Huge break. And I think that's her good luck charm. A Lindsay at home staying up watching her, she said, would bring her luck tonight.
Well, the hard part is done. Tish Johnson knows exactly what she needs. Already trying to fight back the emotion. Still needs to stay behind the line and knock down 6 pins.
6 pins. Trying to hit the head pin, basically.
Just get it off your hand, and she does. 8's more than enough. And Tish Johnson celebrates with a hug from her good friend, Aleta Sill. But Tish Johnson becomes the 1992 BPAA United States Open champion. A hug from mom and dad as now they've got a U.S. Open champion in the household. The final score, 216 to 213. And Tish Johnson's overcome with emotion.
And there's her last shot. She's just trying to get it to the head pin, and as she did on the last shot, went very high on the nose, knocks him out.
And Tish Johnson said this was her tournament when you talked to her earlier today. And you know what? She was right. We'll be back with more after this. Being brought to you by Bud Dry. Dry brewed so it drinks light, yet satisfies completely. And by ESPN Home Video, producers and distributors of Teaching Kids Bowling. Available at video and retail stores nationwide. All right, Tish Johnson wins the 1992 BPAA United States. First and foremost, Bill Blue, the chief executive officer, will present you with the winning jacket.
Tish, congratulations. A traditional jacket for a great winner.
Oh, it looks like it fits pretty nicely.
Hey, it even matches.
You wore a matching outfit. That was smart. Also, the president of the Bowling Proprietors Association of America, Wally Hall, has the trophy and the check.
Tish, here's your trophy on behalf of the 3,500 members of the Bowling Proprietors Association of America and your first place winner's check for $18,000. Congratulations. Great victory. Thank you.
I would like to thank the BPAA. The staff at Fountain Valley, I mean, it was great. I'm glad all my friends and my family and everybody could be here. And I'll wear this jacket proudly. And here we go.
All right. We'll be back to talk to the 92 U.S. Open champion and ask her how she won here this evening when we return to Fountain Valley. All right, Mom is applauding. A special moment for you. You said earlier today that you felt like this was your tournament.
I've never won a major, and I was so close 2 years ago that I really came out and I just wanted to stay focused, and that's what I did. I paid off.
Jan, a question?
Tish, the right-hand lane appeared to be breaking down for you. You went Brooklyn a few times. In the 10th frame when you needed a mark, did you consider just trying to go Brooklyn again?
I stood exactly the same place. I wasn't going to move. I carried two Brooklyns. I figured, well, I might get lucky and just stayed right there.
Well, when you win a U.S. Open, well, you go into the history books forever, and that's what Tish Johnson did here this evening at Fountain Bowl. So long, everybody, from Fountain Valley, California. Next week, the LPBT.